Okay, so today we'll be discussing a new chapter, that is learning and memory in physiology. Okay, now this learning and memory is a very important topic for everyone, because whatever we see, whatever we do, or whatever we read, everything must be learned and memory should be there. So this learning and memory is a dominant hemisphere. Okay, it's a function of dominant hemisphere. Now we have different hemispheres, mainly dominant and non-dominant hemispheres. What is that, sir? See, listen carefully. This dominant hemisphere, we call it as categorical hemisphere. And what is this non-dominant hemisphere? It is a representational hemisphere. In dominant hemisphere, 96% of the right-handed people, they use or they have a dominant hemisphere. And 70% is like me, they're having, mainly the left-handed people like me, they're also having dominant hemisphere. What about this non-dominant hemisphere, sir? Less amount of left-handed people. So less amount of left-handed people will be having the non-dominant hemisphere. Simple. Okay, so what we discussed, dominant hemisphere, also called as categorical hemisphere. Non-dominant hemisphere, also called as representational hemisphere. 96% of the right-handed people will be having this dominant hemisphere. Also, 70% of the left-handed people will be having this dominant hemisphere. What is the function of this, sir? Very important. The function of the dominant hemisphere is language. Okay? They have a good memory. And also, very important, logical-based reasoning. Okay? Logic-based reasoning, they have very good in those hemisphere. What about non-dominant hemispheres, sir? So they are having a specific orientation, intuition-based thinking, where whatever they do, they become creative. Okay, they become creative, and also they have a very good musical skills also. Okay, that is called as a non-dominant hemisphere functions. Okay, if there is lesion in the dominant hemisphere, we call it as aphasia. Okay, aphasia. If there is a lesion in the non-dominant hemisphere, we call it as astigmatism. So, astigmatism means what? See, I'm able to see the black ink marker. Okay, with my closed eyes also, I'm able to orient myself where is the black marker. That is astigmatism. So, absence of this astigmatism, we call it as astigmatism. That is seen in the lesion in the non-dominant hemisphere. Very simple, right? Okay, so we are having it as left hemisphere, also called as dominant hemisphere, right hemisphere, also called as non-dominant hemisphere. Very simple. Okay, so this is about the difference between the dominant as well as non-dominant hemisphere. Next, we'll be seeing about something called as memory, explicit memory. And we'll also see definitions of learning, memory, and difference between the explicit memory as well as implicit memory. What do you mean by learning, sir? Learning means what? A process of acquiring information. Okay, so whatever I'm saying, you are acquiring information. And what is memory? So whatever I say, you must store that information in your brain. That is memory. So storage of the information. Very simple. Now, what is this explicit memory? So, memory is it is classified into explicit and implicit memory. So, in this explicit memory, it is nothing but conscious memory. So, whatever I ask you, you become conscious in viva. In viva conditions, okay, they are the professors will be asking you questions related to the subject, and you answer in a conscious manner. Suppose they ask you a place where you're from. Okay, so place or any facts related thing or events they ask you, you are able to answer. That is the explicit memory, also called as conscious or declarative memory. Now, one more important thing. So, it is for remembering, right? So, if you are able to remember the places, the facts, it is called a semantic memory. if you are able to remember the events of a particular memories, I went to park, I went to, you know, we had a beautiful memory, you are able to remember those things, that is called as episodic memory. So these are the terms you have to know. Okay, so places and facts, they are called as semantic memory. The events we call it as episodic memory. Now let us move on with the implicit memory, also called as subconscious memory. This is conscious, and that is subconscious memory, also called as non-declarative memory. Okay, now if they tell you to tell about the procedures or show me the skill, then you get this thing, procedures or skill memory. We have the what brain, it is the basal ganglia striatum, mainly the procedures and the skill memory, it is for the basal ganglia striatum. What about priming memory? It is for the neocortex thing. And the conditioning memory, if you see, it is the amygdala and cerebellum who is controlling those memory. Okay, so we learn about three types of memory in implicit, also called as subconscious memory. What are those things? Very simple. Procedures and skill memory. You show me this particular skill. You go for practical classes. They ask you what's the procedure for this. You tell me the skill. How will you do this? Then you use in which type of brain it will be? Basal ganglia. What is priming memory? It's for neocortex. And what is the conditioning memory? It is for the amygdala or the cerebellum. Understand? Next very important topic we are going to learn about is synaptic plasticity. It's the basics of memory. Okay, the basic of memory is synaptic plasticity. Okay, now this synaptic plasticity, when you are giving a stimulation to it, okay, so there is a stimulation of the synapse. So when there is a repeated stimulation of synapse, it can either increase the response or decrease the response. Remember carefully, the synaptic plasticity is a basic of memory. And when you are giving a stimulation, the repeated stimulation if you are giving to the synapse, you can either increase the response or decrease the response. Now what will happen if there is increase in response? That is called as post-tetanic potentiation, or there will be long-term potentiation. This long-term potentiation is the best feature where you will see hippocampus. So that is long-term potentiation. Understand? If there is decrease in response, you get a depression. Which depression? Long-term depression, which is seen in cerebellum. Very important. You can ask your mama question, confuse you. But there is increase in response, long-term potentiation, where you will be seeing hippocampus. When there is long-term depression, that is cerebellum. Very simple, right? Now this increased response is for sensitization. When there is a decrease in response, it will cause habituation, right? Now we are going to go to a topic of hippocampus proper, right? Now this hippocampus, they produce a neurons called as CA1 neurons, right? And this CA1 neurons, they are responsible for your short-term memory into long-term memory. They are going to convert the short-term memory into long-term memory. Now, what is a CA1 neuron, sir? They are called as memory neurons. So, CA1 neurons, they are called as memory neurons, and they are responsible for the converting of short-term memory into long-term memory. Very simple. Right. Now, this sensory inputs of these things will come from two pathways, and the overall pathway we call it as afferent or perforent pathways. Afferent pathways. What are those two pathways, sir? Very simple. One, it is direct pathway. The another one is indirect pathway. But the absolute response where you will be getting from which neuron, sir? CA1 neurons. Right? Now, how it comes from, you will see. What is the direct pathway? Listen carefully. This direct pathway, it comes from the cortex, one kind of cortex called as entorhinal cortex. Right? This entorhinal cortex is the component of limbic system. So when you learn about the anatomy, try to learn about this cortex also. entorhinal cortex comes from the limbic system, and this entorhinal cortex is going to activate directly your CA1 neurons. That is direct activation. What is the indirect thing, sir? Very simple. Same entorhinal cortex will be activating to the dentate part of the hippocampus, and it is going to activate your CA3 neurons. Okay, be specific. It is CA3 neurons, and that CA3 neurons is going to activate your CA1 neurons. So we call it as indirect pathway, right? Why? Because see, very simple, your entorhinal cortex, you are going to activate your CA3 neurons, and this CA3 neurons is going to activate your CA1 neuron. Now listen carefully, the conversion of the CA3 neurons into CA1 neurons is called as Schaffer collateral. Very important term, Schaffer collateral. The conversion of the CA3 neurons to CA1 neurons is called as Schaffer collateral. Okay, very important thing, right? Now, only when there is a repeated activation of synapses. Now, let me ask you a question. So, whatever I'm saying to you, does the short-term memory convert into long-term memory, sir? No. So, what is going to happen? What you need? You should have a repeated activation of synapses, which means what? We always tell you to revise. So it's not one-time learning, it will not be converted into long-term memory. You should revise a lot to get it into long-term memory. So repeated activation of synapses is going to convert your short-term memory into long-term memory, right? And those consolidation of the memory, okay, this conversion of short-term memory to long-term memory is called as consolidation of memory, also called as long-term potentiation. Now you tell me, long-term potentiation is a property of hippocampus. This part I want everyone to know. Now long-term depression is a factor of, is a property of cerebellum. That's all. This is the overall concept. Now let us see the next part 2 of the learning and memory. Okay.